I'd like to thank the organization and particularly Richard for inviting me to talk about the sustainability projects in the University of Las Palmas. First, I'll try to be brief because we haven't got much time. Anyway, Now, the term sustainability can be obscure from some people, but the United Nations, how can I put the following slide? I don't have any control. Okay, as you know, the United Nations set 17 Sustainable Development Goals, or SDGs, to set the pathway to sustainable, to endless development. And as you may know, we can classify them in three different types of goals: economic, environmental, and social goals. I'm going to talk only about environmental goals because other units in the university deal with those related to human development or economics. Next, please. As you know, the university has a unique power to help the society to implement the SDGs, because we can have three important tools, which is research, teaching, and social involvement. So first of all, we must be able to implement SDGs in our internal structures. Otherwise, this will not be the message to the university and to the students can be distorted. So let's start with water. I will talk about energy and mobility, and later water, and at the end I will talk about environmental education. Next, please. Regarding energy and mobility, one of the first initiatives we implemented was the Conecta application. Conecta is an internal network made of sensors and computers in the university that can help anyone inside the university determine the consumption and even the production of energy in almost all the buildings of the university. It's not all the buildings are connected, but most of them. Next, please. Next slide, please. As you can see, it's not very clear, but we can have a detailed measurement of the consumption of energy consumption. Every 5 minutes, we have a measure of the consumption of all the in this case the buildings you are watching there, and you can from that you can have information about the for example, if you have a nonsense consumption, for instance, a bigger consumption during the night than during the day, or an unbalanced trifacic connection, etc. Next slide, please. The idea was not to have only a management tool to determine, for example, the effect of changing light bulbs to LEDs, or the effect of energy saving with solar panels, but also we think that this is a very powerful tool for research and teaching. So we are now having, in the last month, we have been assisting to the reading or defense of the first projects, in this case of students, but some teachers are preparing their doctoral thesis with this application. Next, please. Another interesting point is that in the last 10 years approximately, we have been building solar panels on the roofs of 11 buildings of the university. This energy is sold to the, well, this is managed by an electric company, and they pay back to the university about 10% of the solar energy produced, which is about 24,000 euros per year. In the last year, we started the operation of two solar plants on two buildings, one in the campus of Tafira, which with an energy saving of 70%, and then the other one in the campus of Taliati with a lower energy saving of 15%. Well, the fact is that this building is consuming much more energy than the previous one. Next, please. We still have a lot of room for installing new panels, and the idea in this moment is to install them, but for self-consumption rather than for selling the energy. So now we are in this moment trying to install these new solar panels since we have a lot of surface available on the roofs. Next, please. Another interesting point is that we had a blast after one year and a half. We have been able to contract the European warranty of energy origin. This means that the electric company must assure you that you are consuming 100% renewable energy. So we all know that nowhere has 100% renewable energy. In fact, here in Gran Canaria is about 16%. But the idea is that the electric company has to buy in renewable energy the amount that you are consuming, which is not renewable. They can buy that energy in any other market, but globally, you can say that you have 100% renewable energy. Considering that the renewable energy has assigned almost zero carbon footprint, we can say that in the last year, our footprint has been greatly reduced. Next, please. This is the certification. Somebody can think that this is only an administrative measure, but it is a clear commitment of the university in favor of the installation, the implementation of renewable energy in the Canary Island and in general. So this is very interesting when you are participating in international scores such as Green Metrics and so, since this will allow you to reduce your carbon footprint dramatically. Next, please. Another interesting point, which is maybe only testimonial, but it's very important, is that we have the compromise to change all the car fleet of the university, which is not very big, but it's about five cars, to electric. We have started with the rector's official car, which is now an electrical vehicle, and we have calculated that the CO2 production it has been reduced about 50%. And the idea is, well, the idea is that in the future, as the cars become old, their useful life becomes ended, they will be changed to electric vehicles. Next, please. It is very important in the case of mobility to work with the stakeholders. These are private and public companies, and authorities that will help you to implement your project. In this case, a new company appear that hires electric motorbikes. So we are, next please. We have signed an agreement with them to promote the use of electric motorbikes in among the university community, particularly among the students. And it seems that things are going the company is growing up fast. Next, please. We also work with another company, and this is a national company called Ciclogreen, that promotes the use of more friendly or more environmental friendly means of transport, such as the bus, trains, and bicycles. And we made a first try with these people, and it worked reasonably right, but because at this time they only were using bikes. But now they have a more they have access to other more friendly means of transport. They offer gifts, for example, discounts in restaurant or presents, etc., to the student, and it's as a way of rewarding for the effort to use more environmental friendly means of transport. Next, please. Water, yes, thank you. Water is a very scarce commodity in the Canary Islands, and we have been experiencing a lot of problems with water, particularly in the campus of Tafira, which is the biggest one in the Canary Islands, and it contains a big surface of gardens and agricultural land, etc. And the first thing we have to do was to study the leaks we were having in the water distribution system. And there were the system was very old. It was we had many leaks, and the first thing we had to do was to stop these leaks, and the university has been working hard on this subject. Next, please. One of the most interesting projects we have in the campus of Tafira is the natural wastewater treatment, which is composed of ponds and constructed wetland, and is treating water from the nearby buildings and cafeterias. This system has been used as a demonstration system for students and visitors, and also for research. But now we are using the treated effluent to water the palm trees. We in the campus of Tafira, we have a very interesting forest of palm trees, the autochthonous Phoenix canariensis, and these plants are having many problems with different pests imported from different countries. So they are now with the dryness we have because of the climate change, they are demanding water, and we have just a few months ago installed the system to distribute this the effluent of the wastewater treatment to water those ponds. Next, please. Well, this is the study we made about the health state of the palms. As you can see in the picture below on the left, some of them have lost their canopy, and the main problem is the lack of water, because these palms were used to separate different agricultural lands, and now the irrigation system has changed, and they are not receiving water. These plants need water. Okay. Next, please. Another interesting project with the best acceptance by the students was a project which was intended to be used to fight the impact of plastic in the oceans. We started by installing free sustainable drinking water sources in almost all the campuses, not the buildings, but the moment. but in all the campuses. And we also gave 4,000 in this year, 4,000 reusable bottles to minimize the use of plastic bottles. We went to almost all the faculties, not only here in Gran Canaria, but in Fuerteventura and Lanzarote, to give the students their bottles. And all this was accompanied by conferences on the impact of plastic in the ocean and why they should reduce their plastic consumption. Next, please. Well, the final point is environmental education. Maybe this is the most important part of our work, and we all know that this is a long-term work, but it's maybe the most important. We have been collaborating in a national campaign called Libera, which is basically collecting rubbish from different places. This was the first we made in the campus of Tafira. As you may see, we were about 10 or 12 assistants, but in the following project, next please, next slide please, it was in a beach about 15 kilometers far from the campus, and we had at this time we had 40 people cleaning the beach and separating the trash to have an idea of what kind of trash we were collecting. This was an interesting project because people came to clean. And at the end, we gave them a little detail, sometimes a glass, sometimes a reusable bottle as a souvenir of this of the event. Next, please. We have also been organizing different. In this case, it was about energy, sustainable energy and transport, and this was aimed at this journey was aimed at the engineering students. It is important to say that you can work a lot, but at the end, if the people doesn't come to then does not assist, all that work is wasted. So it is important, in particular for the students, to give them something back as a gift or anything else. In this case, they were having credits for their degree. Next, please. Next slide, please. We in the campus of Tafira, we have a nice, as I said before, a nice representation of the Canarian autochthonous flora, and we have been organization reforestation campaigns. The picture, the photo you can see, it's about the conference that a companion, a teacher from the Faculty of Geography gave to the students, talking about the importance of the autochthonous Canarian flora, since we are a biodiversity hotspot in the world. And at that day, the students planted about 150 plants. And later we, since it's not raining anymore in the Canary Islands, we have organizing watering campaigns to keep the plantation. Next, please. Next slide, please. Next slide. Okay, it is also important to work with our other external organizations that or as the case of stakeholders in mobility, we having waste management, different organization that come to us to work with the university students, and we have been collaborating for many years in this case with an association called Canarias Recicla. Next, please. Well, okay, now it's It's okay, 26, please. Well, another important point is that nutrition, in particularly in the Canary Islands, where we have a high index of overloading in many people, we have been promoting the consumption of nearby ecological products. So it is important to collaborate also with an external company that provides these products. And we have been making the propaganda, let's say. Next, please. And last, we have also been working. This was in the Faculty of Marine Science. We've been collaborating in the day of the World Ocean Day, with different activities. In this, some of them were conferences and panels. And in this point, we gave, as you can see in the picture, we gave to the assistants reusable bottles, very good ones, made of steel, and with it's a nice initiative to promote the image of the university and also to reduce the consumption of plastic bottles. Next, please. And last but not least, the Uniplanet project that we have been developing in the last months, just before the coronavirus crisis. It was funded by the Canadian government, and we have to organize a lot of different activities, including beach cleaning, snorkeling, a course of vegan cuisine, and many other activities in just 2 months for thousands of students. And this was a very interesting project, since we have to, well, my idea was very simple. I have the money, but I have not the workers, and I have to call the companies or the associations that work in this field. And it was everything very, very fast. But at the end, we can say that it was very, very interesting, because we were able to move a lot of people. In fact, we were about to install a 70 meters long panel made of recycled plastic pieces, but this was banned because of the coronavirus crisis. But I hope that at the end of October or November, we'll be able to finish this activity and some other activities that became pending. Okay, well, this is anything. Well, I didn't have much time. I hope I didn't bother or bore you too much. And I don't know if we have the chance of questions or whatever. This is all. Thank you very much.
Thank you, José Alberto, for this interesting presentation of what we're doing at the University of Las Palmas de Gran Canaria. I'm sure that at the end of the two presentations, there will be a few questions. Now I am going to give the floor to our second guest speaker, Professor Daniela Baglieri from the University of Messina. Professor Baglieri, I've turned you into a presenter so that you can click on the slides yourself. You just need to click on the slides at the top of the presentation to move slides, basically. It's going to be easier for you to organize your presentation, I guess. So I'm giving you the floor right now.
Good morning to you all. It is a noise. Good morning.
Good morning.
First of all, let me thank you for
giving me.
Good morning. Let me thank you for this kind invitation. The University of Messina is joining the S group for first time, and so we are very glad. Emilio Manà, the colleague who is the referent for University of Messina, and on behalf of the rector, we want to congratulate for this group and for this kind of invitation. So. Let me talk about our experience in order to boost some sort of ecosystem, local ecosystem, which aims to hit some goals that complement the previous presentation. There is an echo. Okay. That complement the previous presentation, which is a different story about sustainability, which is a sort how to hit some goals in terms of social dimension and also environmental dimension. Just because we are at the a sort of newcomers in this group. Let me spend just a few words about our university. We are in Sicily, so from an island, Las Palmas, to another island, which are Sicily, in the south of Italy. And we are a generalist university. We enrolled at least 24,000 students. They are split in 90 degrees program. We have 8 degree in English and also double degree. We have also a PhD program we can share with other universities. And we have 4 campuses in Messina. This is a scientific campus, and the central campus, which is focused on social sciences, and also we have two university hospitals with all the physicians there, and we have a lot. We are boosting and increasing our relationship at the university level with some cooperation. So. That's why we were so glad to join you. And also another story that is relevant is University of Messina is one of the most ancient university in Italy. And we have a up and down like as usual, and we try to boost the numbers in terms of student, in terms of cooperation, international cooperation, and also in terms of interdisciplinarity courses. And so just to start, we were to share our story because we are in the south, and the south of Italy compared to the north is experiencing a decreasing rate of GDP. We are losing, unfortunately, a lot of students that from south go to the northern in order to find a job or to have more chances. So in this way, we wonder what is our role in our country, in our area? How can we actually put in practice the so-called third mission? How can we attract people go here, coming here, in order to around some sort of inter-institutional relationship with other actors, local actors, such as banks, companies, SMEs. So how can we change our mindset? Because we are, as a public administration, are much more focused on the procedures and administrative stuff. So we want to change a little bit our mindset, turning from bureaucratic mindset to much more entrepreneurial. In order to do that, we tried to boost our entrepreneurship course, starting from one idea. The idea is just to exploit much more better in the market some valuable research outcomes. So we start to patent a lot of technological research outcome. In order to explore these patents, we start collaborating with large company, with also multinational that have some headquarters also in Sicily. So we start a sort of dialogue with the local company as a much more large companies, and also we try to create new companies as a sort of academic spin-off in order to boost also the entrepreneurial mindset in our young researcher, young professor, and in a sort we try to combine the existing, the incumbent companies in the local and also the new companies in order to create some sort of interdependencies or the linkages. In order to do that, we try to boost also, we try to create in a public-private cooperation an incubator. And this incubator is an academic incubator, just to hosting some sort of courses and also smart working. And in this way, we try to create a little bit an entrepreneurial environment close to our campuses. But this is not sufficient. And in order to do that, we try to create much more ideas, much more we boost academic research, but we need the talent. So how to attract the talent, or how try to which kind of value proposition we can offer in order to do that? And in this way, 3 years ago we launched a project, and we call this project Smart Me. Smart Me stands for Smart Messina, and Smart Me is an initiative which is a local or a university of Messina, in order to create some sort of digital platform in our city, just putting some sensor in the city and also in the province of Messina, in order to get some data, and this data, which are environmental data, in order that they are open. So in this way, we create a similar digital platform that we can boost for different and also for several goals. The problem was, how can I put this sensor in a private house? How can I put this sensor in public building? So we needed to start a sort of conversation. We need to engage also other people. And the dialogue was a failure at the beginning, because nobody was interested. Nobody was, how I not take care. I have time to share with you this kind of project. So at the beginning, the problem was how to engage people, they are not interested in the university, they are not interested in this talk. So in this way, we had some idea, and the idea was that we launched a sort of a crowdfunding, and this crowdfunding, so was a crowdfunding initiatives of University of Messina. We were at least one of the previous of the first university in Italy to launch a crowdfunding in this way. And the goal of this platform, of this digital platform, was split in three steps. First, we want to engage people, stakeholders, institutional stakeholders. It's not only institutional, but also companies and also private donors. They want to be engaged in this sort of a new vision for the city. The second step was just to gather data, and the data for environmental data was open for other people that want to use this sort of data, and in order to create different services or new services for the city. And the third goal was try to use this sort of data also for internal goals, for internal topic. For example, try to create some sort of course in digital technology and entrepreneurship in order to create a new business model and give a much more fertile environment for students. So there was a good way to share different goals with different actors and also to be engaged in something new. In this way, we launched the video. We convinced the one colleague of engineering department to upload the project in EPLA. EPLA is a Italian crowdfunding website. And of course, the goal, the real initiatives was not to get money, because the problem was to involve people, is not money. And we doubled our goal, because the goal was only 15,000 of euros, and we reached more than 30,000 of euros, and much more. We had 84 donors, and so in this way we shaped our from top down, we shaped our ecosystem. We create an ecosystem which were focused on our donors. 84 donors split in companies, local companies, but we had also three companies from US that believed in this project and invest in this project. So in this way, we create Smart Messina, and we have the citizen, the municipalities, we have some spin-off, we have the internal office of a university. So we were able to start a conversation for the future of the city, and in this way we call the project Smart Messina. Well, we create this sort of, and we put more than 100 sensors in the area. So we are here, the Messina is there, and we create a sort of area, putting different sensors in the area. The sensors are different, and they gather data from pollution, for the pressure, for humidity. So there are some sort of environmental data that collect all together in an open way. And we in this way, we create some sort of app, and for air pollution, it's some sort of a monitor. And we had also several requests from local citizens that put the sensor in the building in order to increase the valuation, the financial valuation of the building, in order to say, hey, this is my house, and if you want to buy my house, you have some sort of certification, there is no noise, and it's also healthy, because the pollution is in the rate of air pollution is very, very low. So in this way, we can create some sort of financial impact from this data that we collect, thanks to also to Arduino. And another application that we developed was also for smart mobility. So traffic is one of the most important problem also in Sicily. So, and talking about smart mobility, sometimes people create some sort of nonsense. But we try to organize the mobility, the urban mobility, and order to give much more information about loading park, they're free, and also the mobility and how to connect the bus with the cabs. So in this way, we have some sort of new application for this. And another application which was very request from the tourists was a sort of city tourist point. So in all this, you can see from this picture, there are some lakes. In Messina, we have some lakes and also the sea, the Mediterranean Sea. And in this way, we can create some sort of naturalistic, environmental, very attractive point, and we can add more value to the tourist service for both for citizens but also for tourism. In this way, we try to connect the much more how a university, how can boost the local and to give much more service beyond teaching and beyond also research. And the third step was to how can we use all this data internally? And internally, jumping from or linking different departments from engineering to our business school and the Department of Economics, we create much more courses, our executive courses, but also for master courses in digital technology and entrepreneurship. And the idea was, how can we boost also creativity of our student and say, hey, we put in the table this data, try to organize something new for the citizen, for the city, and create an entrepreneurial way, a new business model. In this way, we try to we start a conversation, internal conversation, which is still continuing in our university, in order to create much more dialogue also between the 12 departments, because sometimes we try to have some answer to the question, not in interdisciplinary. The disciplinarity is very sometimes hard to achieve. In this way, if we sit in the same table with a problem, and the problem is how to attract people, how to attract company, how can create companies. So starting from data, environmental data, we can see some sort of a little bit of impact. We create 4 spin-off from this project. We have more at least 8 patents from this project, and we try to go to the next step, just to create much more cooperation in this sort of smart Messina. So all this stuff, how can we learn from this experience? We try to wonder if we are just thinking, where is our role as a university? So where is the role of a university? So because people and all the community is watching us, and they watching and they are creating much more expectations. Sometimes we say, oh, how can we do that? And in this way, cooperation is a good way to try to create linkages with different actors and try to start conversation. Another topic that I put is just food for thought for this webinar is, what is the role of technology transfer? What is the role of the so-called third mission of the university? How can create value starting from research, and how can this research can be turned into growth, into GDP? This is a good question, and I know that around the world, other regions, other countries are also questioning this kind of topic. And third, another question is, how can we change our governance? Because the university governance is really crucial, is really critical in order to succeed in this sort of project. So in this way, we want to be much more sustainable, and the sustainable is the first financial sustainable, and then creating impact. The impact is of course social, but also turning, in our experience, turning the environmental data, we try to create much more social impact in terms of innovation, in terms of create a new venture creation, and also to attract young people and to create to increase the employment rate. Of course, this is just one story that we want to share with you, and hoping to start a conversation with all the partners. And in this way, we want to link IoT, entrepreneurship, and education. And in other way, we are ready for being much more sustainable. Thank you for your comments, and hope to and I hope to see you physically in the next time. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Baglieri, for this very interesting and instructive presentation. Well, the two presentations have shown us how you can incorporate a little green mindedness into our daily student life and amongst our university staff, I would say, in order to help to create a more sustainable campus. Based on José Alberto and Daniela's work and findings, and taking into account these two good practices, it is possible to derive some important lessons for the implementation of sustainability strategies in higher education, of course, in higher education institutions. And I'm pretty sure that you're going to have some questions that participants want to ask questions to José Alberto and Daniela about this interesting topic. I've already got some of them here. I've got a series of questions to Professor Melian. The first one would be, what are the main challenges to implement the SDGs at ULPGC? I'm going to give the floor to Professor Melian. Yes, José Alberto. José Alberto Millán.
Can you hear me?
Yes. So what are the main challenges? That's question one. What are the main challenges to implement the SDGs at ULPGC?
Okay, in my opinion, the main challenges are two different goals. The first one, in my opinion, is the education, the awareness, the environmental awareness. I am talking only about the environmental side of the SDGs, okay? But the main challenge is the education of the people in the university. One of the things we have made is it was a consult of the transport means for in the community, in the university community, and 90, I don't remember now, but more than 90% were using the car to go to the university. So the main challenge here is of course to make the university more environmentally sustainable, but the main challenge is the education, the environmental awareness of the people, from the rector to the last student. Okay, so education.
And in the same line, how would you? And that's the same person asking, you know, how you would value the commitment of the members of the university, you know, academic staff and students, to supporting the university's sustainability efforts. Is there a lot of commitment? Are they all committed?
No, I wouldn't say that there is a high level of commitment in the university community. And talking with people from other universities, we say that there are two levels of commitment. The first level is to say that you are very sustainable and that you support any sustainable initiative from the government, the university, or whatever. And there's a second level that which is very more difficult to get, and is what appears when you have to do something to be more sustainable. For example, to leave your car in your house and to catch the bus or go by bike. So the second level is the interesting one, and we don't think that we are getting that level as fast as the climate change is requiring.
Now, concerning this, another question concerning money, always an interesting issue. How does the ULPGC in this case cover the initial costs of a change towards sustainable solutions?
Well, we have a short budget in the Office of Sustainability. We have an annual budget, which is never enough to all the things you can do. And quite often we get also money from the local authorities. For instance, I said before that UniPlanet was a project financed by the Canadian government with 70,000 euros. And it was a very good economic injection for environmental education. The problem is that, as you know, education is a long-lasting, a life-lasting activity. So the idea is to be able to have this support, economic support, every year, not once every 3 or 5 years. But basically from the university and from the local authorities.
Another question has to do with spin-offs. Are there innovative spin-offs from ULPGC that tackle sustainability issues?
Yes, in fact, in the UniPlanet project, we went to go for spin-offs that working environmental education and we need more spin-off, of course. We don't have too many, but we have some. For example, in oceanography, the Faculty of Marine Science, we have some spin-off funded by students. Well, they are not students, but they were some of students. But we have some spin-offs from this point, from the environmental point of view, but we need more people working in this point.
Right, and there's also the coordination. I mean, the issue of the coordination between the ULPGC and the ULPGC's sustainable efforts with the local administration, with the regional authorities, and also with other learning institutions, schools, for example. So how close is the coordination between ULPGC and schools, other schools, or administrations on the island?
Well, it should be closer, okay? Because well, talking only about environmental sustainability, you have so many subjects on the on your table that you need, well, I am a teacher, I am a researcher, and additionally, I am the director of this, of the unit of sustainability office, and the day has 24 hours only. So it could be improved greatly, and it should be improved, but being a teacher and a researcher and the director of this office doesn't allow to get all the coordination we need. Anyway, we try to coordinate assisting to events in high schools, trying to organize the, for example, the transport to the campus of Tafira, which is located outside the the city of Las Palmas de Gran Canaria, with the council and with the stakeholders. But the problem is that we have we haven't got a structure, consolidated structure in the office. I mean, next year maybe somebody else, the director, and this situation should also change.
Okay, and is there, that's maybe a last question for you, Professor Melia. Is there a consistent, I'm reading the questions that have been sent to me, is there a consistent and comprehensive sustainability strategy at ULPGC, like, you know, a written document? Or is it part of the overall institutional development strategy?
Well, the point is, well, I've been working here for 2 years and a half, almost 3 years now, and the idea was to try to implement those initiatives that we thought that were urgent to implement. For the moment, we don't have a written document that summarizes all the ideas. But we have particular project, okay. But this is a question of time also. I mean, I'm working on that manuscript, but we don't have it yet.
Thank you, Professor Melian. We've got some questions as well for Professor Baglieri. Is your mic on? Yes. The first question is about the University of Messina's achievements so far to engage in sustainable higher education development, such as blended teaching, learning, service, and mobility. What could you tell us about these achievements?
Well, we are starting. We are at the beginning, as I told you before, and it's really hard to engage people. We and people in the local area, because they say yes, we are sustainable, but then it's really hard to get more active. This way, we try to create some sort of smooth or plain project, small project. And so the achievements are at the beginning. We have much more spin-off. Our spin-off are I'm led from professor, not from student. And this was our criteria, because the problem of a spin-off is not just creating spin-off, but guarantee a sort of growth condition. To grow, they require large company and interaction for the with them. So in this way, we try to boost a technology transfer through spin-off only to professor. We have some products, so that's not just spin-off for attracting public fund, but just for having an idea for sustainable in a sustainable area. We have a spin-off that create a new materials for the new material for try to face a struggling with the pollution from the sea. So, for example, and in the blended learning teaching, we have a great achievement because also engineering students try to thinking about not only technically but also from a market point of view. So in this way, they're wondering, oh, I can protect this idea, or I can extract money from this idea. So this is great. And of course, we are at the beginning. We launched this project 3 years ago. And now, what's next? The next step is just to enlarge this conversation, including different department, and also try to create other project and launch the same project in other city in Sicily. So that's our next step: create cooperation with other university in other city in order to replicate SmartMe project.
Okay, and there's another question. I've got another few questions here. How has the University of Messina's energy management changed in the interest of implementing SDGs?
Yeah, thank you for this. Thank you, because you gave me the opportunity to see a little bit some words about our energy program. We have also some green public procurement. So also in our administrative project, in tender, we try to put in practice the green public procurement scheme. And we put some solar energy installation in the new building. And we have some sort of smart mobility within the campuses in Messina. We offer bottle to our students in order to decrease the use and the consumption of plastics. So we have different projects also inside our campuses. First, energy, and then mobility. These are the two topics that we are working on.
And same as for Professor Melian, what about the commitment of the university and of the whole university community? Are they committed to all those changes?
Sorry, can you repeat again? Because there are some...
Yes. What about the commitment of the members of the university, of the committee, the community, sorry.
Yeah, the commitment of the Department of Engineering was very high, and also from the government. I'm the Vice Rector for Research and Third Mission, of course, so we had a strategic plan. We have a document, we shared the document, we work all together of the program and for our strategic goals in terms of sustainability. The way we translate sustainability in different, because the sustainability is a broad cover a different topic. So for us, our priority is the first try to attract people in terms of students and try to give provide condition in order to find a job or to create, much more better, to create a job, because we are in a highland with the environmental condition very, very high, and sometimes we lack some social condition, some sort of mobility, infrastructure. So I guess in this way, and also the COVID-19 learned a little bit, teach us that we can provide a lot much more, try to boost digital technology. So in this way, the commitment from the governance was very high, because we believe in digital transformation. How can we put practice? This is another story, because in this way we try to struggling with some sort of problems or impediment, but we can do that. So we try to and leverage the digital transformation in order to create much more opportunities for young people, but also for women, and all in terms of inclusiveness. So that's our goal.
Yes, and the last question, and we've seen the impressive effort you've made, you know, to join with different stakeholders in the region. How did you manage to do that?
Okay, can you hear me? So, at the beginning, as I told you, at the beginning we had no commitment. Nobody was interested, because when I went to the mayor of the city, he said, "Oh, okay, we want to be crucial. We want to create a local ecosystem, because of the literature say that." I said, "Oh, okay, I don't care, because there is no money. I don't care." So that was very difficult. Then I realized, okay, I launched that crowdfunding campaign. So the crowdfunding campaign is just a way to collect money from people spread around the world, okay? Of course, we communicate the project locally. And then we had 84 donors. They said they accept to install to a sensor in their house. And we split the donors in companies that want to work with us, and then citizen and also institutional part. So the CTO and all the public administration. In this way, we set the table, one table, all together, 84 donors. So in this way, I create the ecosystem with this kind of a trick solution. So crowdfunding was very fantastic at the beginning, because otherwise it's a way to attract the attention, to draw the attention of people. Otherwise they say, I don't want to be in this project. So it was very hard at the beginning, but then when they realized there are some, all these services for the citizen, for tourists, so they say, "Oh, okay, of course, the university sometimes can be also useful for the local needs." Strange, but that's true.
Wonderful. Well, it's good to see your enthusiasm as well. You're very, and both of you are very enthusiastic. And I can imagine the work being carried out in your universities must be fantastic. Thank you very much to both of you for this. For these wonderful presentations, examples of good practice, and I'm sure that we all have some examples, you know, similar to what you're doing in our respective universities. There's so much to say about this topic, and well, again, thank you very much to both of you. Thank you. Now we're going to come back to Sabine's presentation, and I'm going to give the floor to Armin in order to introduce Sabine. I just want to remind all of you that this one day conference is being recorded. The whole conference will be recorded. And so after today, when you want to come back to some of these presentations, to listen again to these presentations, you'll be welcome to do so. Arnim, the floor is yours. In order to introduce our guest speaker, we've had, I think we're having problems of connection, but I mean, I've got the feeling that now it's working. I can see Sabine. Arnim. Arnim, the floor is yours.
The floor is yours.
Yes, I can see her.
Yes, I'm again here. I'm still here. Can you hear me?
Yes, I mean, I can hear you.
Yes, I mean, I can hear you.
I was waiting for Arnim's presentation, but I can't hear Arnim. So we'll give you the floor straight ahead. So Sabine Poole from the EAIE, I'm sure Arnim would have given a much longer presentation. I'm really sorry, but I'm sure you can introduce yourself personally. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much. So that's the second try, and I hope that this time you can really hear me. So a big welcome. As Arnim said, I'm right now president of the EAE, but also working at the University of Graz in Austria. I would like to thank you much for this kind invitation to this conference, and I would also like to thank you for the great topic, because what you managed is that all the hot issues, what is burning underneath our fingers, you're dealing with in one day, which is a very challenging idea, I would say. Of course, we at EIE, we have sustainable internationalization on the agenda of our different expert communities and of the communities, but driving responsible higher education is a core element in our existing strategy. And when we connect with our members, with the EIE community, and these are practitioners and professionals working in the field of higher education, we are very often given examples of grooming of comprehensive internationalization when talking about sustainability. And when it comes to these grooming issues, we find in the institutions that this can be embedded in different ways, as you all know. It can be in the curricula, whether this is a single individual curriculum, whether it's a joint initiative, whether it's a compulsory part in different courses, no importance. But grooming is really on the rise. You all know that research is working on it, and a lot of additional money is available to help us save the world next to pharmaceutical industry, I think, right now. But it cannot be ignored on the agenda. When it comes to driving responsible higher education, we at the EIE, of course, want to create an awareness at our conference. In the past, we did so in conference and at the academy. We hope so next year again. But when maybe some of you attended our conferences, you saw the conference bags, very easy, the conference bags that support an initiative from South Africa. Or we have the water bottles that you can reuse. You have the coffee cups that are biodegradable. You, for example, feel that there is less paper that's being used. If you find paper, it's basically secondhand paper, reused, recycled paper. We try to further improve our app in order to be able to sneak away from the paper. What we also did is we reduced the number of meals where we offer meat, which also helps the environment, and we are planting trees. So with every 10 euro that you pay to come to our conference, we do plant a forest. We have a forest in the Netherlands, we have forests in Asia, because we know that our carbon footprint is nothing we can be proud of in organizing a conference with 6,000 plus people. And the carbon footprint, we also heard, at least I heard some couple of sentences, that more and more universities do monitor on. The first speaker I heard was really showing in a very impressive way all the charts. And SDGs, in general, they are on the agenda at the institutions, also when it comes to cooperation with our international partners. So exchanging best practice and finding joint ways for the future. When it comes to international corporations, now there are new developments. And strange enough, one of the very few positive aspects we've been facing and we've seen within the last couple of months is that these new formats of cooperation and exchange, the virtual aspects, are on the rise. There is an awareness now that's being created in the institutions. And about 2 weeks ago, we had a very good EIE summit, 2 days event, and one of our speakers, Rob O'Dowd, he really brought to us in a very impressive way that the future at our institutions will be with virtual aspects. It's not so much the technology, me speaking, who was disconnected for 2 hours, but it's not so much the technology that our challenge is. It's more the methodology that has to swap. But the teachers, the academics, now probably need some extra training. And you, if you have devoted teachers, if you have students who are willing to go on this new trip, who have the virtual cooperation, go in a virtual mobility, and then, of course, to a physical state, then this is a much stronger, sustainable idea of international cooperation than maybe it is when simply sending students back and forth without this special support given. And the European Commission, as we all know, is taking this from the radar under the name of blended learning, and it will be a central aspect in the new E-Plus initiative. So this was just what I wanted to mention a couple of hours ago. I'm happy that this way now we connected. If you have any questions, I hope that I am still connected and I'm willing to answer questions and start a chat. Thank you. I can't hear anything now.
I I hope Sabine and everybody else can hear me.
I think.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much
for your presentation. Thanks for being so committed. Making this work together with the wonderful IT team of the University of Las Palmas. It was a pleasure to have you on and get a perspective from Insight and from the top at the same time of the EAIE on current discussions and developments. And indeed, the EAIE summit lately was also very inspiring. And I'm very sure that there are many questions. So the first questions that I received was, and this reflects a little bit on what Michael Gabel from the EUA mentioned in his presentation in our last webinar. What are your concerns? And I'm also coming back to the open letter that you wrote on behalf of the EAIE a couple of weeks back. What are your concerns with regard to a decrease in funding of international higher education by national agencies as the European Commission?
When it comes to funding, I think it's very obvious that the money we have to spend right now in supporting our society, in further development of pharmaceutical help, somebody has to pay for it. And unfortunately, I think that when it comes to teaching, when it comes to international cooperation, it's not on the forefront. So research might survive, I personally feel, but although we all are very committed and strong believers in internationalization, we have to face some cuts, some financial cuts, both in our institutions, there for sure, but also from the side of the Commission, unfortunately.
Of course, we all know that there are things that are more system relevant, as they were called during the 19 pandemic. Another worried question concerns the awareness and the support of global higher education mobility that may shrink, and that would influence budget concerns of the sector in the long run. Are there discussions within the EAIE community that you would like us to be aware of, Sabi?
When it comes to mobility, unfortunately, I have to say that due to the fact that many of the cooperation we were able to deal with in a virtual way, now gave food to the supporters of mobility is not necessary. I think it's more necessary than ever, because on the agenda we all have that we want global citizens, right? We want people who support our initiative, but for that reason they have to get their butts off their seats and go abroad. But there are different aspects of mobility. The virtual mobility I mentioned here, which can be now stronger connected to physical mobility. But in Europe, for example, there are many initiatives also from universities to find different ways of mobility. Not everybody has to fly. There is extra financial support when you go by train, which of course is the truth for both students and for staff, and maybe for longer stays. So with the blended mobility, the short-term programs are now back on the hype, and this is impressive since we saw that what started 20 years ago and we supported students to go abroad for a full year, now we are happy if they go for a short term 2 weeks. This has to be strongly connected to a strategy in an institution. But we have to pay a closer look what's going on in our institution. We have to have a look at the financial support, but there are ideas how to further develop them and strengthen our field.
And Thank you so much. That brings me to the next question that concerns exactly the conversations and discussions around a healthy, balanced approach towards, on one hand, face-to-face interaction, and that concerns research, that concerns teaching, that concerns service support, and of course collaborations, institutional collaborations, and digital mobility. There are chances there, but there are also threats, not only opportunities. I would like to know what you have in mind with regard to what could be a balanced approach. How could we assess a balanced approach? When really to travel, when to send students for the real intercultural experience, and what to take as an opportunity to develop our internationalization at home that we were discussing and developing for a couple of years already, but that we can maybe use this to develop that further.
This is a very good example that you mentioned, internationalization at home. I think this is the time to now have a look at our curriculum and how we can actually connect the students and staff who are not mobile, but get them acquainted with the international agenda. So time-wise, I think this is important. When it comes to mobility, in the past, indeed, there were tendencies that for meetings, and here I'm talking meetings of staff and academics, for half a day, for 2 hour meetings, people were traveling around the globe, right? The past has shown for, it depends, if it's simply a meeting like we are doing, digital solution can be one very green aspect. What is missing though is the creativity. I mean, the two of us, Arnim, together with our colleagues in the chat, we can give our rounds of the virtual mic, but when we want to develop something, if creativity needs a place, when we need a cup of coffee or something else to get new ideas, I'm convinced that this meeting format is not what we need for the future.
There's always now various detailed estimates to be made. And then we might find a healthy relation of the effort and of course what we want to achieve. And that is very important. In very general, we have two more questions in the chat. I don't know if you see them. There are two questions. How do you foresee that internationalization will develop in the coming years, and how will mobility will continue to play a role in the
coming years? And how
these questions already, but please, just if you have any take on these, then I would like you to come back to these two questions as well.
Okay, as mentioned earlier, I think that physical mobility is important, and now more important than ever. When it comes to sustainability and mobility in this aspect, what surprises me a bit, and I'm sure that Arnim, you are with me, now everybody's talking about sustainability in internationalization. But I personally have a feeling that in our area, this is what we've been working on for the last years already, because we were not simply looking for a quick win situation. We wanted to make it part of our reality on our campus and in the international community. But for this, we need the support of physical mobility with all aspects. It has to become greener, but it's a necessity, and I'm very much convinced of that.
Here, and this is a wonderful point that hints to our next panel, actually, after our break, because there we will continue to talk about healthy balance of benefits and contributions, or cost to benefit ratio in internationalization, because there are of course some doubts about how much flexibility and a personal approach will be diminished maybe, or at least affected by more digital activities. On the other hand, of course, digital innovation in international higher education is necessary, and I'm looking forward to talk about this with Frederick from the University of Ghent, having in mind also the remarks from Wolfgang from NTNU, from Trondheim, from our last webinar. And I probably would like to thank, before another time giving Richard the floor, would like to thank everyone who was participating, everyone who was preparing and supporting the event in the background, and also technically, and especially, of course, all our wonderful and very inspiring speakers who have made this morning today a very valuable and interesting one. I enjoyed that very much. And of course, to all participants, I would very much hope that we see each other again. We have now planned a break of 90 minutes, and we'll meet again in 90 minutes, which will be in the Western European summertime at 12:30. In Central European summertime, it will be at 1:30. Before we let you go, I would be happy to give the floor again to Richard, because the University of Las Palmas is, together with the S Group, the host of this event.
Thank you, Arnim. Thank you, Sabine, for this great presentation. And I mean, just before the break, maybe I would like to make, I mean, wouldn't it be a good idea to switch on our webcams, all of us, and I take a screenshot? There are about 50 of us connected at the moment, which is wonderful. It's a big challenge, as you know. Organizing web conferences is always a big challenge. So if you can turn your webcam on if you want to, and there's no obligation, but we can take a screenshot and see each other. Hello, everybody. Great. I'll wait for just a few seconds, and I'll just take a screenshot. We're all smart. We're all looking very smart. Okay. A few more. Wait a little bit more. Right. Off we go. Great. Wonderful. So, I'll take another one here. So we're meeting in, Arnim told us, I haven't got the program in front of me, but we're meeting in, at 12:30, as Arnim said, 1:30 Central European time. So a bit more than an hour and 15 minutes. So I would have liked to invite you to a great coffee break with typical Spanish pasta, Spanish food, or sandwiches, or whatever. But again, I really hope you can have that conference or another conference here in Gran Canaria at some time later on, maybe next year or the year after, with proper drinks, proper food, to be sad. But I'm sure we all have a break now, a drink, and we all need a little bit of a rest. But again, I just want to tell you that you're more than welcome at our university whenever you like. So see you in 90 minutes. And thank you again, all of you, for your great participation. Thank you.